Thank you very much for the stimulating start of this nice evening. Thank you very much and welcome you all. Dear Professor Töpfer, dear Professor Haag, dear Michael von Winning. I'm very pleased to welcome you here today to the opening event of the Young Academy for Sustainability Research. It is wonderful that it is possible again for us to meet here, to come together live and in person, and I'm also pleased that numerous people have joined us online. My name is Angela Kleinschmidt, and I'm professor for forest and environmental policy, so that you know to whom you are speaking for. Someone said I'm the Waldfee here, so, and the vice president for internationalization and sustainability here at this wonderful university, Freiburg. It is a very special honor to me to guide you through this evening, as I had the great pleasure to follow the process of the Young Academy from, well, rather from the beginning. And it's absolutely exciting that today is the day when everything gets officially started. And of course, there have been many people during this process who have supported the Young Academy for Sustainability Research. I ask you to accept my apologies right from the beginning that I will not mention everybody who has supported the project, and that because there have been many here, and most of you are in the room as well. But I want to mention at least a very few. And this is first of all the Eva Meyer Stiel Stiftung, today and in this room represented by Michael von Winning from the Board of Directors. So thank you very much for being here with us today. And the Eva Meyer Stiel Stiftung financially supports this new academy, and this enables us to start a promising new network for international early career students. This is for you. I'd like to name as well the Frias Institute and its director, Professor Bernd Kortmann, who will come to stage later on, hosting the Young Academy at the Freiburg Research Center for Advanced Studies. I think there couldn't be any better place where the Young Academy should stay. We can have a round of applause for Frias and for Professor Kortmann as well. Yes. And I guess some thanks should go as well to Dr. Michael Vollstedt, who has organized not only this evening, but who is in charge and responsible for the Young Academy at the Frias. Thank you very much, Michael Vollstedt. You are a great organizer. So, last but not least, I'd like to thank the fellows. I see some of you here in the room. I guess not everybody can be here, but it's because of you. You decided to join the Young Academy, though it is a new network. There has been an overwhelming interest, at least it was overwhelming for me, of international, excellent young researchers from disciplines as diverse as you can think of. And now you are the ones who, well, take the helm from today on, which is a very great chance for you, but as well for the University of Freiburg. And at the same time, it's a sort of a responsibility. The university, and in particular, the rector of our university, has clearly announced that sustainability is at the heart of our university and at the heart of our future plans. So the Young Academy for Sustainability Research comes at the right time, but as well to the right place here in Freiburg. And I'm very happy to hand over to the rector of the university, Professor Kriegelstein. Ms. Kriegelstein, the floor is yours.
Yeah. Thank you very much for this introduction and the opening. Dear Professor Töpfer, dear Nadine Sandkast, dear Major Haag, dear Michael von Winning, dear colleagues, ladies and gentlemen. The connection between knowledge and society is in no other current pressing topic as close as in the case of sustainability. Science happens here in the tension between urgent problem solution and battling alternative facts and ignorance. The question of verified knowledge and its conclusion frequently challenged not only the society, but also the scientists. This is vividly demonstrated every day by media discussion about the climate crisis and its consequences. This is precisely why it is important to scientists to keep asking questions and thus to contribute to a sustainable society. Environment and sustainability is one of the profile areas in research at the University of Freiburg. In addition, we anchored the central issue of sustainability on a strategic level by installing the Vice President for Internationalization and Sustainability in person of Daniela Kleinschmidt. However, in order to ask and answer the pressing questions of our time, science cannot take place without the exchange with the society and politics, as the corona pandemic has definitely shown us. Therefore, I am very pleased that Professor Klaus Töpfer, Minister Thekla Walker, and Major Professor Martin Haag are participating in this event. Furthermore, I'm particularly pleased to welcome Michael von Winning as representative of the Eva Meyer Stiel Stiftung. We highly appreciate the long-standing cooperation with the Eva Meyer Stiel Stiftung and its generous support, so which we are able to initiate new projects and intensify our research, particularly in the field of sustainability. In result, scientists and research networks were supported, professorships created, and buildings constructed. The cooperation with the Eva Meyer Stiel Stiftung thus builds bridges and creates ever new connections. Specifically and today, the support of the Eva Meyer Stiel Stiftung offered us the opportunity of the opening of the Young Academy of Sustainability Research. This academy brings together young scientists from different places, disciplines, and contexts to generate new knowledge, to tackle future societal challenges, and to facilitate the cooperation with outstanding researchers in Freiburg on urgent research topics in the field of sustainability. As our international research college, the Freiburg Institute for Advanced Studies, FRIAS, is the ideal place for this. FRIAS creates a unique space and atmosphere for research within the university, enriches the global network of Freiburg-based researchers, and enhances the international visibility of research conducted at the University of Freiburg. The Institute offers leading academics as well as outstanding early stage researchers from Freiburg and around the world the opportunity to concentrate exclusively on their individual or joint research projects for a certain period of time. Particular attention is paid to promoting promising young academics, with FRIAS creating ample opportunities for them in national networks by engaging in inspirational discussions and collaborative research with the members of the fellow community across disciplines and not just academic cultures. Just like the Young Academy for Sustainability Research starting today, the evening reflects the university's current efforts in the field of sustainability research, but concurrently it marks at the same day a new beginning. This is especially true for the Young Academy for Sustainability Research and its members. I wish you all stimulating ideas and the great scientific success to tackle the urgent society challenges of our future. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for the kind greetings and nice words for the starting of the Young Academy. And it's my great pleasure to pass now over to Ms. Thekla Walker, our Minister for the Environment, Climate and Energy Management here in Baden-Württemberg. And she has sent us an online greeting. So let's welcome her on the screen then.
Sustainability, with its three dimensions of ecology, social welfare, and economy, raises a multitude of questions simply because of its complexity. I am very pleased that young people want to address these challenges and meet the conflicting goals with their research approaches. It is therefore an honor for me to be part of this very special inaugural event of the Young Academy of Sustainable Research. After all, research and interdisciplinary discourse are practiced at the Young Academy from the basis for the transformation towards a sustainable way of life. The focus of the Young Academy's research is on highly topical issues. The sustainable energy transition involves a whole range of difficult challenges, from environmental risks to distribution problems, which will be addressed in future research projects at the Young Academy. Finding new approaches for a successful transformation can be a goal of the researchers. Involving different disciplines leads to new solutions. Another focus of the Young Academy is the understanding of green infrastructures. Of particular interest is the implementation of these in social ecological systems. Questions arise, for example, about the vulnerability and resilience of individual groups. The Young Academy aims to find answers to these questions. The Freiburg Institute for Advanced Studies has created an institution here that also allows students to organize themselves and their work to a large extent and to set their own priorities. Not only are the views of young people incorporated, but care is also taken to ensure that international and interdisciplinary exchange takes place. This is precisely the way of working that promises success in the field of sustainable development. Research institutions like the Young Academy support ecological change by giving us scientifically sound basis for our decisions, not only in politics, but also in our private lives. I am sure that institutions like the Young Academy will provide impulses and impetus to society and thus actively accompany the change in our way of life. Only through the efforts of all of us, for example, can we effectively protect the climate. New creative approaches will help us on this path. Finally, I wish all future members of the Young Academy for Sustainable Research much success with their research projects, and I'm looking forward to the results. Thank you very much.
Now we come back to the city of Freiburg. Our university is placed in a unique city, and I don't want to disseminate that it is not only, maybe not in all cases, only the university, but as well the attractiveness of the city, why Freiburg is attractive for students and for fellows. So in particular for those who are of interest in sustainability issues. The relations between the city of Freiburg and the university are close, and we are very pleased that the city of Freiburg is today represented by Mayor Professor Martin Haag. He's a mayor in Freiburg who is responsible for urban development, construction and mobility, and who is committed to these issues in a sustainable and eco-friendly way. Mr. Haag, welcome, and the floor is yours, please.
Yeah, dear Professor Kleinschmidt, ladies and gentlemen, On behalf of the city of Freiburg and on behalf of Mayor Martin Horn, I would like to welcome you today to the so-called kickoff of the Young Academy for Sustainable Research. And I would like to start by expressing my gratitude to Eva Meyer-Stiel Foundation for the great contribution it is making here again. For decades, it has been one of the biggest supporters and advocates of the University of Freiburg. Mr. von Winning, I'm pleased that you're here with us today. Thank you. So, the Young Academy for Sustainable Research fits only too well in Freiburg, because here the topic of sustainability has played an important role for a long time. Environmental and climate protection have been a topic in Freiburg and in the Freiburg politics for decades, not only in politics, also in administration, and also among the citizens, also among the university. In the 1996, municipal climate protection goals were formulated here for one at the first time. And with its ambitious environmental policy and a clear politics and city commitment to sustainable urban development, Freiburg has made a name for itself worldwide as a green city. And it was already named Germany's most sustainable large city in 2012. And another funny aspect, Freiburg has just today been rated as a top travel destination worldwide by Lonely Planet. And also because of its efforts in sustainable urban policy. And environmental policy, solar technology, concepts for sustainability, mobility, climate protection have become drivers to our economic, political and urban development. And here in Freiburg, science and business work hand in hand, also with us from the city administration, as you already mentioned. A good example is the Transdisciplinary Sustainable Performance Center, an alliance of Freiburg University and the Fraunhofer Institutes, joined by a network of internationally active companies. As mayor of this city, I'm therefore very pleased that university, with its long tradition of sustainability research, is now receiving a further boost thanks to founding of the Eva Meyer-Stiel Foundation. With its great funding, new opportunities are created to make sustainability research even more efficient internationally, and at the same time, the University of Freiburg can strengthen its profile in this field furthermore. However, this young academy is not only important for the university. Through the commitment and research of the area of sustainability, of course, the city is all ultimately benefits. For example, you are planning public events and conferences to bring the important topic of sustainability into the society and into the people of Freiburg. I can only welcome this, because we can only master the current challenges together. Sustainable is a task for society as a whole. And I hope, at least, that the young scientists will feel at home here in Freiburg for this time they stay here, and would like to extend the warm welcome to you all. I wish you many good ideas, and I look forward to exchanging them with you. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor Haag, and congratulations to the first place of the Lonely Planet. Number three. Yeah, it will be number one, I guess, in 1 or 2 years from now. Absolutely. So I'm sure the Young Academy will stay in contact with you, and you will hear from them. And now it is with my great pleasure to welcome Professor Kortmann, Professor of English Language and Linguistics at the University of Freiburg, as well as the Director of the Freiburg Institute of Advanced Studies, as you have heard already earlier, the organization of the University of Freiburg hosting the Young Academy. And he is now the one who will explain to us what it is all about. So please, you are welcome to the floor, Professor Kortmann.
Dear Dear honorable guests, dear Academy members, dear ladies and gentlemen, this official opening of the Young Academy for Sustainability Research is a true highlight and a most precious and memorable moment in the 13-year history of FRIAS, even though I keep stressing that this is a young academy at FRIAS, not by FRIAS. Nevertheless, there has been a lot of FRIAS behind this academy in the past 12 months, both in the conception phase and the practical implementation phase. The latter involved recruiting the staff and, above all, managing the application process, culminating in the selection of 16 academy members from more than 200 exclamation mark international applicants, always in close consultation with the experts in the sustainability research centers of this university. These prominently included Daniela Kleinschmidt and Michael Pregernik, and many thanks again to the two of you, to Carsten Dormann, and also to the Dean of the Faculty, Heiner Schanz, for the smooth and extremely supportive collaboration in all JAS-related matters. And by the way, also many thanks to all the people of the JAS and FRIAS teams who have planned this event and who are making this a success tonight. Thanks a lot to all of you. A brief look back at the conception phase. Here I just want to say that we at FRIAS have always thought that a young academy would make for a perfect match with our institute, especially given our strong emphasis on A, supporting early career researchers, B, fostering interdisciplinary research, and C, international networking. And just as an aside, why the very term young academy? Isn't this kind of belittling successful early career researchers, all of them established postdocs who have already mapped out for themselves a successful international research profile? The short answer is, Young Academy is simply the established label for this type of institution in Germany. There are several young academies, not only at German Academies of Science, but also at individual universities, also at the oldest Institute for Advanced Studies in Germany, the Zentrum für Interdisziplinäre Forschung in Bielefeld, ZIF, and its young academy has been known as the Young ZIF, das junge ZIF, for more than 20 years now. But, yes, members, listen carefully, maybe you will come up with a fancier, less ageist label at some point. So what about the Next Generation Academy for Sustainability Research? Think about this, always provided that the funders are happy with it, and you can sound out Michael von Winning during the reception. Anyway, all of us here in the room need to say, and many people have done this already, a super big word of thanks to the Eva Meyer Stiel Foundation and Michael von Winning personally. Without them, this idea of a young academy could never have been realized. Moreover, this novel idea of a young academy that has an umbrella topic, which is completely unusual, and on top of that, an umbrella topic that which perfectly fits both the research profile of the University of Freiburg and the funding profile of the Meyer Stiel Foundation, namely sustainability research. Now, we all know that this is a truly vast umbrella topic. When we advertised the call for the academy memberships, our sustainability experts at the university decided to sharpen this umbrella topic somewhat by inviting applications contributing to one or more of the following five broad research domains: environmental risks, adaptation, vulnerability, and resilience, innovation for sustainability, systemic transitions to sustainability, and, more from a social sciences point of view, power, responsibility, and sustainability. Our hope and expectation is that the current first generation of JAS members will zoom in on a small subset of much more focused research topics in their collaborative research and outreach efforts over the next 2 years. Promising candidates we currently see on the horizon are sustainable energy transition, green infrastructures, and climate change adaptation in cities. But this is all still subject to change and evolution. Above all, it is subject to the outcome of the discussions among the Academy members themselves over the next 2 days, weeks, and months during their 2-year membership. What the audience must know, it is one of the founding principles of young academies that they operate bottom up and not top down. They are largely self-organizing, and the way they go totally depends on what mutual interest the current members have and what they want to focus on. So the 16 members of the YAS crowd first need to find out a lot about themselves in order to determine what they want to collaborate on and how they want to go about it, both in times of shared presence at FRIAS and during the much longer periods in between when everyone is working at the home institutions. In that respect, it will certainly help that half of the members work at the University of Freiburg and that, as of this month, three JAS members will spend between 10 and 24 months as junior fellows at FRIAS. Finally, two wishes from the FRIAS director. First of all, that we succeed in triggering a lot of interaction between the JAS members and those FRIAS fellows and research groups working on different facets of sustainability from different disciplinary perspectives. My second wish is that the JAS group will see a way of linking up with our Maria Sibylla Merian Institute for Advanced Studies in Africa, short MIASA, which, as some of you may know, was established in 2018 and is located in Accra, Ghana. This institute, managed by FRIAS, has a pronounced focus on sustainability governance with key research areas such as the sustainability of democracy building and ecological transformation in sub-Saharan Africa and the Global South at large. My personal offer is this: let's jointly work on the fulfillment of both of these wishes. End of a slightly too long speech. I know, I sense every one of you wants to know more about these people. Who are they? What do they think what sustainability is or should be? Here is the answer. There is a video coming, and off the show goes, I'm told.
Hi, my name is Ida Walling. I work at the University of Freiburg, where I do research about forest and environmental policies in Europe and in Ghana.
Hi, my name is Javier Francisco, and I work at the University of Freiburg.
Hi, my name is Corinna Köpke. I'm working at the Fraunhofer Institute for High Speed Dynamics, and I'm working as a researcher in the field of resilience of critical infrastructure.
Hi, my name is Osama Hussain, and I'm a lecturer at the University of Oxford in International Relations.
Hi, my name is Christina Spinoza.
My name is Chad Zanacco, and I'm a postdoctoral scholar in civil and environmental engineering at Stanford University.
Hi. I'm Rita Souza Silva. I'm a researcher at the Freiburg Institute for Advanced Studies and a fellow at Young Academy for Sustainability.
Hi, my name is Thilo Wirtz. I'm a geographer at the University of Freiburg.
Hi, my name is Leila. I'm a postdoctoral researcher at Mercator Research Institute on Global Common and Climate Change in Berlin, Germany.
Hi, I'm Severin, and I work at the University of Freiburg on electrochemical energy systems.
Hello, everybody. I am Sarah Mai. I am a cultural anthropologist and work at the University of Freiburg.
Hi there. I'm Matthias Kranke, and I'm currently a postdoctoral researcher at the University of Kassel in Germany.
Hi, I am Rike Zinder, and I'm a postdoc at the University of Freiburg, and I'm currently working on climate change law.
I'm Benjamin Schütze. I'm a junior fellow with the Young Academy for Sustainability Research at FRIAS.
Hi, my name is Sahani Patharaja. I'm a postdoctoral researcher at the University of Potsdam in a collaborative research center on data assimilation.
For me, sustainability is about identifying the global challenges that we collectively face and coming up with equitable solutions that will last far into the future.
For me, sustainability means that we apply methods to consume resources in a way that our planet is able to recover and to finally preserve it.
For me, sustainability is looking at the whole picture. That means considering all impacts and internalizing all costs of technology, environment, and society.
Sustainability for me means that we think with a long-term perspective and we are aware of what we do today will have an impact in the future.
In a nutshell, sustainability means that we shape our world while empowering future generations to do the same thing.
Sustainability for me is about finding creative ways to assess and balance the needs of the many.
Sustainability is for me about a transition to energy democracy to thereby enable new social, economic and ecological futures.
A balanced human environment system when the value is diversity, equity and well-being for all.
For me, sustainability means the capacity of the present to meet their needs without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs.
Problems at the interface of nature, technology, and society are highly interdisciplinary by nature. And therefore, I look forward very much to engaging with different people and perspectives within the Academy for Sustainability Research.
I am very much looking forward to having mutually inspiring conversations with other researchers that are as passionate as I am about sustainability issues.
I'm most looking forward to challenge myself and therefore looking at new problems of sustainability from different perspectives, from interdisciplinary perspectives, and therefore applying them and try to find new solutions to new problems that I was not aware of in also new parts of the world.
I look forward to commonly organized workshops, to joint publications, to project ideas that we develop together, and to the inspiration that the interdisciplinary and international exchange may give us.
I'm most looking forward to learning from my fellow Academy members what they think sustainability is and how it can best be achieved.
I look forward to open discussions with the other members of the Academy regarding the strengths and weaknesses of science and academia today and how we can together make valuable contributions to society.
Well, and for those of the Academy members who are present, I think I was told this is the moment where they should come to the front and then it's time for a group photo or something. So please join me at the front here. And once everyone is here, I think there's another big round of applause and then we continue the program.
Once more? Okay, now it works. Hello, my name is Veronica, and I'm a singer-songwriter. I'm going to be playing some music for you today. I lived and studied in Freiburg for like 6 or 7 years. So yeah, it's nice for me to be here and to see all of this happening. The first song I'm going to be playing is called Patiently Waiting, and it's one of my own songs. Each and every day I've got the choice. I've got the choice which path I'm gonna take. Each and every day I lead my way. I lead my way, and even if I don't know where I'm going, it's gonna be okay, it's gonna be okay. When there's no one left to blame, when I'm done hiding from the rain, I embrace whatever comes along. When I've suffered enough and I wonder how it is to feel alive, to feel alive, to feel alive. Here I am, patiently waiting for my moment to arrive. Until I decide to pick one of these moments and make it mine. Whoa. Here I am, patiently waiting for my moment to arrive. Until I decide to pick one of these moments and make it mine, and I make it mine. Each and every day I've got the choice. I've got the choice whether I turn left or right. Each and every day I lead my way. I lead my way. And if I feel like I've been a coffee break, well, that's okay. Well, that's okay. When there's no one left to blame, when I'm done hiding from the rain, I embrace whatever comes along. When I've suffered enough and I wonder how it is to feel alive, to feel alive, to feel alive. Here I am, patiently waiting for my moment to arrive. Until I decide to pick one of these moments and make it mine. Oh, oh, here I am, patiently waiting for my moment to arrive. Until I decide to pick one of these moments and make it mine, and I make it mine, and I make it mine, and I make it mine. Thank you very much. The next song is a cover song. It's been written from Zaz, and it's called Port Coton. It's in French. Quoi que tu fasses,
Je ne sais pas ce que ça remplace. Et derrière nous, c'est encore un nombre. Faut-il encore qu'on raconte que quelque chose nous revienne? Faut-il qu'on soit seul sur terre, ici aussi? Boire pour la soif, je ne sais pas ce qui de nous deux restera. Tu dis mais je ne regarde pas. Je n'ai jamais vu la mer, mais j'en ai vu des noyés. Comment fais-tu pour oublier, pour oublier? La pluie qui revient dans nos voix, pas une chanson où je ne pense à toi. Dans ce monde inhabitable, il veut mieux danser sur les tables. À Port-Coton, qu'on se revoit, qu'on se revoit, qu'on se revoit. Dans ce monde inhabitable, il veut mieux danser sur les tables. À Port-Coton, qu'on se revoit, qu'on se revoit.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Veronica Mannhardt, for the music inspiring us for the next slot. And what would be an evening like this without a keynote speech? And if you close your eyes and you can think of someone who would be the right person for a keynote speech like this, I guess that many of you would come to the point and would wish for Professor Dr. Klaus Töpfer. And we are so happy and proud that you are here today. Professor Klaus Töpfer, I think I don't need to actually introduce you, but I will do it anyway because this is good behavior. So I will do that and everybody will say, I know that anyways. So Professor Dr. Klaus Töpfer was Executive Director of the United Nations Environmental Program, the UNEP, in Nairobi, and Under Secretary General of the United Nations from 1998 to 2006. He was Federal Minister for the Environment, Nature Conservation and Nuclear Safety from 1987 to 1994 and Federal Minister for Regional Planning, Building and Urban Development from 1994 to 1998. He's also Founding Director and former Executive Director of the Institute for Advanced Sustainability Studies, IASS, in Potsdam. When it comes to environment, climate and sustainability issues, your opinion and advice continue to be a defining factor both internationally and nationally. And we are more than pleased to have you here today and we are looking forward to your comments. Dr. Töpfer.
Good afternoon, Excellencies, Madame the Rector, Lord Mayor, Mr. Kortmann, and Madame Kleinschmidt, waiting for the moment to arrive. A wonderful song, and I am fairly convinced that there are better things for the opening of such an important development than a keynote speech of an old man. It is the contrast, you see, the young people, new ideas, and then comes the so-called wise old man. Don't be afraid. I don't want to bother you too much because you can also do in Freiburg more than only speeches. When I come now those days to Freiburg. I'm looking to other products of this region, and I can inform you, for those who are not originally coming from Germany, it's a good idea, but limited, please. Please, limited. Because he has enough problem with those who are unlimited in this field, and therefore it is a good recommendation. Oh, thank you very much. I'm very honored also to remember that I was once a short time student in Frias, and that I learned that one of the main topics you can learn in those things is to come together and understand the other people. You know, that is a little bit in danger in our societies. We had just an election, as you may know, and as it is in sustainability, three partners. In sustainability, I would even add a fourth one, always forgotten to do so, and that is culture. I come back to this. But there are three. And what is the lesson to bring three different persons, institutions together? You must be open for compromise. If you learn in this academy how to make compromise not as a failure, but as a success, then you run up to the expectation we have. I'm a little bit afraid that we are not making enough the difference between a community and a society. What we call the cancel culture. We are not any more open for implementing democratically developed compromises, because my own topic is not fully aware of this. And therefore, I would strongly recommend to have this in mind. As you know, this is now on the table in Glasgow. There are different activities, different expectations. It was mentioned that I had a chance to be 8 years headquartered in Nairobi in Kenya. And if you come back, you must be aware the differences in this world. There you have the African situation, young population, average age, something about 20 years. In Germany, average age, 50 years. Per capita income in Africa, something about 1,000 and less US dollar. Per capita income in Germany, 50,000 US dollar. This is our world. And this world is growing. When I was born, long time ago, I think all those sitting here, with some exceptions maybe, could be my children. And I'm a very good grandfather for the young one who was here. So I can substitute for a moment only the mother in handling this. When I was born, 1983, yes, 38. Don't be aware, that's a failure of an old man. Do something against this. What do you believe, how many people lived on this global level in the world? 1938, 80 years ago. It is a discussion, friends. You can join us. It was altogether 2.5 billion people. 2.5. How many are we here now? We are just close to 8 billion. Close to 8 billion. In 80 years. And we have to handle those 8 billions, and they are going on, and that is not to criticize. Quite to the contrary. That you must be aware that we will reach, in any case, 9 billion. And we must make this planet Earth a place to live. And then we have to ask, what are the repercussions? Yes, it is very good to learn all this, what you intend to do in your business life, everything is fine. But don't forget to listen to others, to their reputation. In Glasgow, you can see it in the titles of the global conferences. The first global conference of the UN in this field, because quite a lot of people believe that sustainability is environment. Sustainability is much more, much more. But the first title of this conference was 1972, the United Nations Conference on the Human Environment in Stockholm. I strongly recommend, not only to the Young Academy members, but to everybody, please, go on the internet and read once more the speech of Indira Gandhi, 1972. What was the main sentence in this speech? Are not poverty and need the greatest pollutant? And I quote from this speech, how can we speak to those who live in villages and slums about keeping the oceans, the rivers, and the air clean when their own lives are contaminated at the source? She made the direct contact between development and environment. First United Nations Conference on the Human Environment. 20 years later, that was already my time, 1992 was the second conference of this kind. That was not the second conference on the human environment. What was the title? The conference on UN Conference on Environment and Development. And believe me, I was in those days a minister here in Germany. And we really toured the world, especially in the southern part, to convince people to accept this title. Because they were absolutely convinced the title must be the United Nations Conference on Development and Environment. That was a discussion where the E or the D is priority. And we are quite now in this situation again. And they are sitting now in Glasgow. We have to make an open mind to the needs of others and not only to our conviction. If I want to do this, then I can stay at home. And that I'm not allowed to make a climate policy under national considerations. All the problems we are confronted with are now global problems. The pandemic, we learned it again and again. The financial crisis, name them. All this you cannot do in one country, even as we learned it, not in the US or China, in Corona, you was confronted, and in climate, you are confronted with the same topic. So what is the disaster? The disaster is that we need the highest degree of multilateralism at a time where multilateralism is huge under stress. We are going back to nationalistic views. America first, Brexit, name them. And we are in the situation where we are challenging the basis for open parliamentarian democracy. And this is not only to say some critical wording, no. The power goes out of politics and goes much more to other influences. Some erotics mentioned that a result of a, in this case, national election in Germany does not have the chance to change politics at the ground. We are past dependent. We are losing alternatives. Remember, democracy needs alternatives. And the discussion, also the hard discussion, is not A disaster for democracy is a precondition for it. And we must have alternatives. You have to develop the alternatives. Maybe they are in the beginning stupid things. Maybe they are all for the side to come, stupid things. But at least don't go only beaten tracks. Then we are in a very, very risky situation for what we call democracy. We are going out of this. Quite a well-known German ecological, economic philosopher, transboundary thinking, mentioned in an article in the weekly magazine Der Spiegel, the rasende Politiker, the rapid politician, or the foreseeable end of parliamentary democracy. And it comes exactly to this situation. We are past the pen. We are integrated. We are, let me say, in a unsolvable integration in the decision of the before taken decision for solving problems. Remember always, please, if you can have some additional topics to consider. Human decisions are always decisions with incomplete knowledge. Human decisions are always decisions with incomplete knowledge, otherwise you couldn't have scientific progress. The scientific progress gives you the signal that what we know now must be questioned. Falsification is a methodology for myself in scientists, not verification. Verification brings you to ideologies. Falsification gives you the critical point that is not an alibi for not action. But please, develop those solutions which are mistake-friendly, which you can change if you have new ideas. Develop those technologies and solutions which are able to be globalized. Make those technologies which are using manpower, not only capital. In the priorities of the Western world, we are always capital-intensive topics. Agriculture in Germany is the second highest capital intensity of the whole economy, the second highest. There is not any farmer anymore. There are scientists with the digital possibilities. This is not a solution for Africa to go. There we need jobs for young people. What can we do without losing the efficiency in using our limited space in agriculture? All those topics are my understanding of sustainability. Sustainability in itself requires compromise. If you only maximize one, you must see there might be negative consequences for a second. If you maximize all we can do in the ecological field, please ask also the consequences for the social consequences of this. Remember Indira Gandhi. Whatever you do there, you must be aware that we need a structured, perspective-oriented economy. What can we do to link those? So to be only looking in one direction is always looking in the wrong one. And therefore, I appreciate that what we learned today again, that the transdisciplinary approach is not only a standard vocabulary, but that should be also integrated in the whole coming together, learning together, making research together, coming to a solution which can also be globalized, can be used for a world with 8 or 9 billion people. A great chance. And I believe also a good idea
to be with young people together and give the old ones the good signal, my friend, you forgot this. And therefore, we had now a limited freedom to decide what is going on. Make alternatives, you know. In Great Britain once was the great Chancellor, Madame Thatcher. And in the cabinet, she was always told, Tina Thatcher. Tina was, there is no alternative. And if you look back in our handling of the corona crisis, there was a lot of Tinas. A lot of Tinas. And in the very moment where you have the Tinas, you have the decrease of the parliament and the increase of the executive side. This is to avoid, because this is a limitation of freedom, and this is a limitation of chances for future. So give us alternatives. Open the eyes, also in direction where nobody had the power and the, let me say, even the courage to do it. One famous researcher in Germany once mentioned that we are in this country eine unter uns gesagt Gesellschaft. So you have your personal consideration, and if you sit with a glass of wine or beer and say, but to say it under us, not so convinced. We don't need this unter uns gesagt Gesellschaft. We need a society which is fighting for the good way, but is also able to make compromises when this is democratically developed and decision is taken. And that could be something like my contribution to this young academy. Unluckily, I'm not sitting with you, because that goes also down the river. When you are older and older, you never have enough time to listen only. You always believe, you know also something here and something there. Don't listen to those. Ask yourself. Make yourself a proposal. I think that is much better than to forget this and be aware that we are in a world where we have the homogenization of technologies, but we have the differentiation in culture. How to bring this together? How bring we that together? Read those papers from young scientists of Africa. Femin Tsar, Afrotopia, little booklet, wonderfully. It gives you a new view. I would see you underlined again and again, they want to be little Europeans, they want Africans. And they want to go their own way. And that's only one quote for Africa. And I hope that you are not too disappointed that I quote Africa only, but 8 years in this great country, continent, gives you a little bit the responsibility. Of course, being in Africa, in any good reason, please quote also Freiburg. That's important, what I learned today. So that was my contribution. I hope that you can see the young people tomorrow morning once more. I have already the honor or the duty to be tomorrow morning at 7 o'clock in the Südwestrundfunk. And I shall say something on Glasgow and by here in Freiburg. But I will start with being in Freiburg. I can give you the best information on Glasgow. Thank you very much.
Dear Professor Töpfer, it's hard to say anything after your speech. It's so encouraging and inspiring. And I'm very sorry, but I have to say one thing was a mistake in there. And that is that you said that well, the keynote speech is not the best of the evening. I think you made it clear that it is something nobody in this room wanted to miss. Thank you very much for your words. And as you have mentioned already, some of the important issues of research, I think it fits very well that we will now have a panel discussion on transformative cities. And I'm very pleased to introduce to you the participants. With Dr. Laila Niemir, Dr. Rita Souza Silva, we have two members of the Young Academy with us on the panel, please. Dr. Niemir is a computational economist working on energy and climate change mitigation. Her research focuses on the science-policy-society interface, agent-based modeling and modeling regime shifts, behavioral and lifestyle changes, sharing and circular economy, SDGs and well-being. This is already a very huge differentiation of topics. You're most welcome. Dr. Souza Silva's research interests are focused on the relationship between urban green spaces and human health and well-being, and as well on the role of tree species diversity for the functioning of forest ecosystems from natural forest to urban environment. So we welcome the both of our new fellows. And additionally, it's a great pleasure for me to introduce to you as well a dear colleague, Arnim Wieck, who is professor in the School of Sustainability and a senior sustainability scientist, actually the sustainability scientist, I would say, at the Global Institute of Sustainability and Innovation at the Arizona State University, and for the moment, guest professor at the University of Freiburg. So whenever he is in the radio, he will say as well, regards from Freiburg, of course. He develops evidence-supported solutions to sustainability challenges and is also engaged in research on sustainability education. And now there is one thing I'm a bit, it's a pity, because actually it would have been my great pleasure to introduce to you as well the moderator of this panel discussion, Professor Michael Bregenick, who is from the Faculty of Environment and Natural Resource at our university here, who is an important researcher in the field of sustainability and a supporter of FRIAS as well. But unfortunately, he got ill and cannot be here with us tonight. So we will send regards in case he's in front of the computer. But of course, we hope, first of all, he's recovering well. So I'm trying to stand in for him, and I hope you forgive me all the mistakes I can do. But the wonderful panel will secure that we will have a nice discussion in the end. So thank you very much. And if you allow me, I would like to stay here as well. And we will start with the discussion. We said that the title of our panel discussion is Transformative Cities. And the question is as well, and this very much links to what has been just said by Professor Töpfer, what is then sustainability? And that was very nicely presented as well in the videos we have had before, where all of you have claimed and told us what you think is sustainability and how would you approach that in your research. And what we can realize from that is there are so many diverse way on approaching sustainability. There are so many way on addressing different topics. It can range from environmental issue over to creative, to arts. It can range to democracy, to technical issues, to many other issues as well. And it can range as well from different regional spaces we can look at. And one of those spaces could be a city. I'm looking at the mayor of the city of Freiburg, where different topics come together. The question of climate change, the question of well-being, the question of urban forestry, for example, and many other topics as well, which are relevant to a city here. So I'm happy that we start now our panel discussion. And I'd like to address the first question. What kind of science does a transformative city need? So, to the panel, what do you think? Yes, please. Okay. Press the button and then we try whether we can hear you.
Okay, perfect. Now it's great.
Does it work? Everything perfect. Is fine.
So always it's difficult to start at the first, but I will try my best.
In my opinion, as we hear in a keynote speak, also in a, it's perfect. Okay. So as we heard in also the keynote speak, that it's very important to have a comprehensive view, have an inter and transdisciplinary approach in the sustainability. In my opinion, I believe that integration and system thinking is vital and crucial for imagining the sustainable future and also designing the paths. So that's why we really do need inter- and transdisciplinary studies, not only collaboration between different disciplines, but also talking to the stakeholders. So to design these strategies, I believe that stakeholders' engagement is a core, and particularly I'm talking about the public engagement and communication. When we have a communication and engagement with the stakeholders and public and communicate science well, we not only can find the priorities and shortcomings, the drivers and barriers of the changes, and also maybe plausible strategies, but also we can share the good practices. We can share that how we can change over the time and different perspectives, and also enable active learning by doing that. So this is a thing that I believe that this is a kind of very comprehensive, it shouldn't be abstract, it's a comprehensive and a joint effort between different sciences and stakeholders through the society.
Great. Oh. I would maybe just add that, especially like from the scientific part, sometimes we need to be proactive, and if we want more voices, we need to be the ones out actually looking for different opinions and bringing people to the science, because sometimes we don't get the view from everyone. And if we are talking about changing cities, what is the city that people want? It's not just us scientists looking at sustainability and how a building should be built or how we should implement a cycling lane or where or which trees, if I talk for my work. But what about the people that live there and what is the best solution? So bring these people first to science and then work with them and then translate this new knowledge to actually to practice and not just be like a case study that can work very well in this neighborhood, but then cannot be implemented in the other neighborhood. So we need kind of solutions that we think about solutions in the terms of the city if we actually want to make a change and not just a nice case study to publish in a nice journal.
Let me just add a few things. maybe it's biting soon. I think I keep trying and we'll see what happens. So this is very unusual. Obviously, this is very staged, right? We got these questions first, and so we prepared already our answers, right? But I want to play a little bit the devil's advocate here. I think, you know, what we see here with the Young Academy is already a very different type of sustainability thinking. Because traditionally, we would probably get the answers, you need hard data, a better understanding of the problem, going deeper and deeper into the cause, root causes of the problems. Because that's what we really do most time in most of the scientific, especially disciplinary fields, right? So hearing about, you know, you need to be out there, you need to be with stakeholders, you need to devise, you know, solutions, and you need to try new things and all of this, I think it's absolutely true, but I just want to, you know, put a little bit framing around this. This is unusual, and this also requires, and I'm not a member of the Young Academy, so I can maybe judge that a little bit from the distance too, right? I feel this is quite wonderful to see. At the same time, you know, the devil is in the detail. Being a good partner to a city as a researcher is not a trivial thing because you have a lot of obligations. You are actually obliged to, you know, participate in your scientific community. You need to publish, you need to look out for grant funding, you need to look out for your professorship, right? That hopefully is somewhere at the horizon, right? So a lot of obligations internally from academia. And so what I would wish we would promote as to become strong partners, really strong partners for cities. And that requires that our institutions, our universities, are becoming more flexible in its structures, are setting a different set of incentives, not just internal incentives about, you know, number of publications and impacts and citation indices and so on and so on. I mean, I could, you know, long, long list, and you all know that, right? But we don't dare to say we need to change our institutions internally in order to become these powerful partners for the cities. So that would be my plea. That's what we really need to do in order to fulfill these wonderful promises of solution-oriented participatory research.
Thank you very much. It sounds a bit like transformation of universities, but okay. Maybe you can share some examples. Now you have uncovered that we have already had these questions on the forehand, but maybe you want to share some examples with us on what could this transformation-oriented types of research look like?
Okay, I can go first this time. Maybe just more about the examples of working with the cities and how complicated it is. Personal example, I was in a panel for, so I was working in Montreal, and Montreal is quite a green city as well, but the green is not everywhere. So there are neighborhoods that are very green, but there are other neighborhoods where there is no trees. And I work with trees, and I want to have trees everywhere. So I was in this panel where there was this call for projects from society, so any other organization could apply, and then the city would fund the planting of the trees and the care for the trees. So I did my homework. I look at the map. I look where there was trees and where the trees were missing. And then I look at the social demographic data, so all the data. And then I get to the meeting and I get the list of projects to judge, and there was no project from the neighborhoods that needed it. So something was wrong with it. And the thing is, those neighborhoods, they don't just lack trees. They also lack the other capacity to actually write a good project, to actually be able to think about where to plant trees and then to follow up with that. So maybe we as university could have come earlier in this process and maybe have helped these neighborhoods to write a nice project. Then we could give our feedback and then something could happen, because in the end it was a very nice nursery home in a very nice neighborhood that presented the best project and they got their trees. But we actually didn't contribute that much because it was not from the beginning we should have intervened first. So that's a not so positive experience, but I hope to learn in the future to, take action earlier.
Rita, can I jump in there?
Sure.
I mean, this is totally, off script, so, we're going into new territory here. But Rita, my question would be, are you then in this process as a researcher or as a community activist? And if you are in there as a community activist, trying to, help them develop proposals, receive funding, plant trees, how do you figure out your roles and responsibilities?
Well, I think you can be both. So like in my case, when I work with the greening and well-being and the health of citizens, so sometimes we want case studies. We want to know if a greening intervention actually had a positive effect or not. Mm-hmm. Did it cause the green gentrification when actually we make people to go ahead? So I think we can intervene as a researcher. We can help think about how we should change the planning of the city. How do we implement change? Which are the different stakeholders that we need to bring to the table? It will be just intervening at a different stage. Mm-hmm. And then mm-hmm. I will not be designing the project and evaluating the project. That would be a bit too much.
Right, but it's interesting to see, right? You're speaking about different roles, so you would need to wear different hats in that process, sometimes supporting the community in writing proposals, planting trees, and then using that intervention for your research to actually study it, and evaluate it and generate, you know, hard evidence that this solution worked or did not, or for some time. And I think that's really important for us to consider, right? These experiences of researchers with these engaged and transdisciplinary and ambitious agendas of making real change, they need to play different parts in this. And that's quite demanding on your time, that's demanding on, you know, again, back to the roles and responsibilities. And again, I would hope that we learn that the institutions in which you are anchored are helping you with this, right? Because you have different needs with those different roles.
That brings me to another question, actually. And this question is, how can then the Young doing so? Because you said it's the institutions that needs to help. So the Young Academy is a new start. So what should the Young Academy do to support this?
Maybe I can say what I can expect from the Young Academy in that way, that just following this conversation that's going on, I had a chance to also work with the different disciplines and different scientists and also businesses, banks, and municipalities, and also policymakers. And at the beginning, as an early career researcher, for me, it was so difficult to understand them because we are talking in the different languages. And this is very challenging and takes time that we reach the point that understand each other very well. And then together we can have a joint effort to solve that problem or go through the strategies. So I think here that we have Young Academy would be a great environment for us. We are coming from the different kind of disciplines, from different backgrounds, and also education and also culture. And this is a best way to we share our experiences from our point of view or what we had in the past as a project, and also, most important, listen to each other, learn from each other, and that brings bringing the great, basically, brainstorming and smart new ideas, and most probably that we might come up with the projects or proposals that we can help for Freiburg or any other cities, that together from the different approaches we can help to go for it. So I think this is very important to have.
Okay, then I will beg for something different. So I will beg something from the Academy. I think like we heard about like changing policies and like listening from the past, but then I think more and more we want also the new generations to have a voice and to actually be asked for when we are designing new policies and new cities. This is the young generation that will live in the cities. So how can we have this new group of young scientists to actually take part when we are designing new policies, when we are thinking of strategically like in 10, 15, 20 years? How can the Academy help us to be part of this process, helping us with the networking, but also with the right mentorship and the right opportunities to actually have an active voice in the transformative process of our cities, the planet, wherever we wish to do in our careers?
Completing the round of wishful thinking here for the Academy.
Why not?
Exactly. No, absolutely. Let's do it. And coming from the outside, I have no stakes and no limits with this too, right? So I think actually going back to the city-university relationship and also the location, I mean, it's such a huge opportunity to have the Young Academy in the Freiburg region. Personally, I came to Freiburg because of this wonderful university, I have to say that. Primarily because of the amazing, innovative spirit, and especially, you know, entrepreneurial, civil society, multi-stakeholder governance, innovation that is happening in this region. The university is one, hopefully, a strong partner in this, right? But overall, it's such a massive amount of innovation and creativity that is in this region. So the one thing I would wish that the Academy can actually do is harvest this place, right? As opposed to, you know, just, you know, bringing you all in and having a good time together, right? Going out there, out of the you know, academy and into the, you know, really innovative businesses that we have, really innovative, you know, food policy council, right? Lots of interesting initiatives going on there. I work mostly on food and food issues, so I'm more familiar with this, right? But there's so much going on. Trying to capitalize, trying to really leverage that place, I think that will be a wonderful opportunity, and I hope the academy can do that. Now let me
be the question is there nothing about science anymore in the Young Academy? It sounds like lots of participation going out to the city and transforming the city. So what about the science part?
I think that's science as well. I think science is not just sitting behind a desk or a laptop anymore. So I think more and more we recognize if we want science to be applied in practice, that's part of it. So it's just actually going, being proactive and going after like different voices, but actually also what are the problems and what are the solutions for the real problems. So I think all of this being involved and yes, not just staying in the academy, but going outside, I think that's the role of science in first place.
Can I say one more thing? I think it's a very, very good and it's a relevant question, because just going out is not... because going back to you, Rita, about you know the type of research you do with the trees, what I learned from all the city university partnerships I was part of over the last several decades was sometimes the confusion of roles is not very helpful. Right, because then there's friction and tension, and some things are falling off the plate. Right, all of a sudden nobody is doing the research. Right, everybody is out there and planting trees, which you know, or the opposite. But I think what you mentioned about interventions and intervention research is really important. Maybe a good share of the fellows might not even know that there is a real paradigm and a school of thought and a methodology of intervention research. That we have actually developed in sustainability science an alternative to the usual human environment, systems thinking, primarily analyzing problems and structures, and have a path that is real, you know, research methodology on how to develop solutions, how to study them, how to evaluate them, how to infuse that evidence at a later stage again in the process. These are all knowledge-generating research activities. But separating them from the community activities is also important, because if we don't separate them in productive and constructive ways, nobody is doing the research. So I think it's very important to be aware of when are we also as researchers, activists, and you know work with the community out there, and when are we also retreating a little bit from those processes and study what is happening from perspective of research, quality, distance, objectivity to a certain extent too, in order to create the evidence what works, what does not work. So some separation of those roles is quite productive.
I agree. But if we need transformative science, if we need transformative cities, don't we need to take a step further and actually take a different hat and try to be more proactive and be more active in our community to actually translate the great science we do to great practice?
Absolutely. I think it's this continuous interplay between those two sides. And what I'm just saying is, you know, in that activism, right, not forgetting to do also the proper research. And then again, you know, taking this as the starting off point for the next initiative, maybe planting the trees somewhere else or linking the trees to business opportunities like alternative, like cooperatives or benefit corporations, all sorts of things that are maybe more powerful than just planting trees.
It's because we want to plant the trees, but we want the trees to live longer. So we need people to want a tree there. So if just as a scientist I said, please plant a tree here,
it's
and the
happening.
Community doesn't want a tree there, the tree
it's
won't
happening.
Stay there for longer.
Yeah.
So maybe I can add something here that regarding to the science communication that I brought at the beginning, that I believe science is in process. I mean, it's not a one step. We are doing that in a whole process. I just want to bring the example here about a diet shifts. We worked with the elementary schools kids. And this is very important, that is part of our job as a scientist to communicate our science. So we had a program with the kids, and we even cook together the food. So this is a very fun, this is a science. We try together where first recognize what's the local vegetables and how they can plant them and how they can grow them. And so they see all the process, and then we can reach the point that they harvest this vegetable and we cook together a vegetarian dish. So this is a signal to the young generation to how they should change this diet shift. And the whole process that parents and also the friends also join. So this is a kind of the science communication and bringing the awareness and knowledge from our side to that. So I basically, in summary, I can say it's the process. It's not a one-time thing that we are sitting. Thanks.
I think what we can feel here is already that our young fellows have listened very carefully to Ben Kortman when he was saying that, well, it's not an approach top-down, it's a bottom-up approach of the young academy, and you have to decide on what you think science is and what sustainability means and how you bring things together. And I think we have already felt that this is a very good starting point on what you did here. Thank you very much for the panel discussion, and good luck for the future, of course. And now I have the chance to invite another time Veronika Mannhardt with a musical intermezzo. So we are looking forward to the next song and whether there is another moment we can get from that.
I get to play two more songs for you. And the next one is also one of my own songs. And unfortunately, I haven't written any songs about sustainability yet. But it was inspiring to listen today. So there might be songs like that in the future. And the following song is called What Comes After Love. Every now and then I think of you. I wonder where you are, and I wonder what you do. I mean, it's not that I miss you, but on the other side, sometimes I do. I miss the way you smiled, the way you looked at me. I don't miss at all how you never let me be. So what comes after love is a bunch of memories and a smile, 'cause finally I can breathe. I can breathe, I can breathe, I can breathe, I can breathe, I can breathe. Every morning I wake up, coffee cup touching my lips, what a nice good morning kiss. And I'm alone, but I'm not lonely, and I wonder if your morning is the same. And I wonder if your morning is the same. And I wonder if your morning is the same. I wonder if your morning is the same. And I wonder if you breathe, if you breathe, if you breathe, if you breathe just like me, if you breathe, if you breathe, if you breathe, if you breathe. Thank you very much. And now this is going to be the last song for the evening, and it's a cover song. It's called Emmylou by First Aid Kit. And I mainly just like the ambience of the song because I think it sounds hopeful somehow, and maybe that's why it could fit to this evening.
Thank you very much for the wonderful music, Veronica. We talked about it, and actually Professor Töpfer talked about it more recently now in his speech, and he was saying that there is different perspectives to sustainability, and we should, cover all of them and not just think about one of those. And I think it's now at the moment that we can talk about a different perspective, and we come back to the culture, which you have promised as well. And We will devote ourselves to an area now that has been not yet too much in the center of the attention, but fits nicely, or rather that overlaps and links between two areas, that one of science and that one of art. Professor Lippert, our colleague from the University of Freiburg, will introduce the Frias artist in residence, Katrin von Lehmann, to you. Thank you very much. Welcome both of them, please.
Hello, I'm glad to be here. Thanks to the organizers for giving me the opportunity to introduce Katrin, because that is an especially great pleasure for me. Katrin von Lehmann is an artist from Berlin, and she will be the artist of residence at the Frias for the next 2 months. And she will also be a guest of two institutions. One is the Young Academy of Sustainability Research. Congratulations that you have her as a guest. And she's also a guest of the Trinational Upper Rhine Network for Science Reflection. That's a network where I'm engaged, and we are very happy to have her. Katrin von Lehmann studied at the Academy of Bildende Künste in Munich in the 80s. And while she was studying, she already prepared her first exhibition, and I think it already shows how unusual her approach is. There she exhibited drawings that emerged from an encounter with two blind people. And so I think this, look at that work, it's really fascinating. It shows that very early on, she looked for what my favorite philosopher of science, Ludwig Fleck, has called gerichtete Wahrnehmungsbereitschaft, or a focused readiness for sensory perception. She lives in Berlin since 1994, and she's a very well-known artist around Berlin. She has received many grants, many international invitations, and she has inspired many collaborative projects as well. But everything changed in 2009. There she received a grant from a museum that I had never heard of before, a weather museum in Brandenburg, the Lindenberg Weather Museum. There she did cloud observation. Ask her about it. You will also see a bit in her presentation in a minute. Since then, she developed a fascination for sequences of action and how they are recorded. She thus built the core of her practice, of her artist practice, around collaborations with scientific institutions ever since, and she has developed a strong focus on epistemology in practice. Meanwhile, she has also built an extraordinarily strong record of science and arts collaboration. I'll give you some examples. She has collaborated with and at several Max Planck institutes. In 2012, she was an artist in residence at the Max Planck Institute for the History of Science in Berlin, for example, and she was a guest of my research group there. It was fantastic. It was super inspiring, very enriching to work with her and all the members of the Academy. I encourage you to talk to her, to work with her, to let her participate in your work. I promise you will be surprised positively. From 2014 onwards, she collaborated with a Center for Climate Research in Norway and the Department of Oceanography and Fisheries of the University of the Azores on a project, on a joint project. In 2017, she received an Istanbul Fellowship and presented her work at the Boğaziçi University in Turkey at the Department of Molecular Biology and Genetics. In 2019, she realized an interdisciplinary project at the Science Art Philosophy Lab at the University of Lisbon. And, that was surprising for me, when the Forensic Science Institute of Saxony was relocated in 2020 into a new building, she was invited to participate in their Art in Building Limited competition. In 2021, this year, at the invitation of the Young Academy of Berlin Brandenburg Academy of Sciences and Humanities, she participated in the interdisciplinary workshop Living with Measurability, Futures Today. And also in 2021, just a few weeks ago, her book Textura Performativa appeared, and we will have a book launch party on the 26th of November here in Freiburg. You're all welcome. Be our guests. It's a wonderful book, I can tell you. And with that, I would like to ask Katrin Lehmann to come on stage and give us her presentation.
So, thank you, Veronica, for your kind introduction. I'm very pleased to be here, to have the possibility to speak. And what I hear tonight was very interesting, and I asked me what could be my part. My art is without sound, but now I will speak in words. Yes, I'm delighted to have the opportunity to briefly present my artistic work here in a place of fruitful and exciting exchange.
Well, the first, okay.
I will show you three of my artworks from different projects. The projects are named Naked Eye Observation in the technique of folding drawings, World Citizen 1735 to 1990 in the technique of photo weaving, and two so-called proxy series from my ongoing project Empty Space of the Unknown, Nothing is Right Now. These are drawings on paper. I mention the techniques because I describe myself as a draught woman who not only uses pencil and brushes, but also works on paper and photographs with a folding bone, scissors, and hole punches. My curiosity to venture into uncharted territory is driven by topics such as the relationship between systematic classification and coincidence in life processes. Within this context, I am interested in the question of aesthetics and how they can be defined. The first work I will show is about observation and its translation into an artistic piece. The title I will read, maybe you can't see it in the last row. Augenbeobachtung 1, Naked Eye Observation. The technique is brush drawing on paper, folded. The size is about 80 centimeters to 2 meters, and it's 6 centimeters thick. It's of the, made in the year of 2010. In 2009, I had a fellowship at the Weather Museum in Lindenberg, a small town 70 kilometers from Berlin. My visit of the meteorological observatory there was fascinating. And one of the questions which immediately came to my mind was, how can we do research on something with something beyond human reach and mostly invisible? On the roof of the observatory, I saw technical devices to measure the phenomena in the troposphere, a cloud scanner, for instance. But this device didn't work properly. And this is why cloud classification is done by human eyes in observatories worldwide. This meteorological work is called eye observation. It was hard to believe that in our high-tech digital age, the human eye is at times more efficient than any technical device. So, that is how my research on classification systems started. What kind of system could classify these abstract or undefined shapes of clouds that are always changing? I read Luke Howard's biography. Howard had developed cloud classification in 1802. And in principle, his method is still used today. For the work Naked Eye Observation 1, I asked the observatory for a set of data from the period of 1 month, March 2009. The data consisted in nearly 900 Latin words, like, for example, cumulus, it means bunch, heap, stratus, it means layer, cirrus, it means pen or ponytail, to name just the three main groups. The clouds are classified every 30 minutes, even during the night. For example, in the last row, it means in the middle, stratus, nebulosus, fractus, these Latin words I worked with. Inspired by the work process of a cloud observer, I developed an artistic process. First, the cloud observer looks into the sky. I look at the data set. Second, the cloud observer analyzes what he or she perceives and matches the undefined shapes of the clouds with a code of Latin words. I try to understand the meaning of the Latin words. Third, the cloud observer writes down the Latin words in a diary. I transform my association of Latin term into a drawing. During drawing, I did not think about clouds, but tried to express my associations triggered by these words. I folded each of the 31 drawings, one drawing for each day, in the same way and staggered them chronologically. This is another work. Naked Eye Observation 2-1, the same technique. My plan was to make a series. So I used data sets from different months from the same observatory. Here you can see the piece Naked Eye Observation 2-1, for which I transformed the data of July 2009. During the work process, I was confronted with an unexpected situation. I read not defined instead of a Latin word. This made me think, how does this translate? By looking at the image, you can see how I have translated not defined. I want to emphasize that this approach does not produce any rejected drawings. My personal judgment, this drawing is good, I do not like it, for example, is of no value. As long as I'm working in a concentrated manner in this process, every drawing is part of the final piece. The next work I will speak about is called World Citizen 1735 to 1990. It's an 8-layer photo weaving. The size is, or diameter is 130 centimeter. I made it in 2013. In 2012, Veronika Lippert from the Max Planck Research Group 20th Century Histories of Knowledge about Human Variation invited me to develop an artwork on the visualizations of human diversity database. The database has more than 500 images, family and phylogenetic trees, portraits, collections, tables, maps, diagrams, and many mixed forms of rendering. This categorization is mostly based on concept of race and, in fact, a reduction of the complexity of human diversity. The research method used by scientists to study details in order to reach generally valid conclusions about people motivated me to work in the technique of photo weaving. What is the photo weaving? Photo weaving is a technique that I developed in the year 2000. It arose from my ambivalent attitude towards photography. On the one hand, I feel excited when I see a photograph, regardless of where it was taken. On the other hand, photography has mutated into a mass product. I therefore cut photographs into stripes and put them together by the method of weaving, thus creating in a new, different work. Concept of this piece. When each single document reflects a partial aspect of human diversity, then by means of an artistic process, that is the multi-layer weaving of photographs, deconstruction and construction, I could create a kind of human prototype called World Citizen. I asked Veronika Lippert to select 20 important documents from the database that was then my source material for an 8-layer photo weaving. The dates in the title of the piece are in reference to the oldest and most recent document. The last work, or the last works I will speak about are the proxy series with the project Empty Space of the Unknown, Nothing is Right Now. This project is an open attempt to define the field of drawing in a novel way by employing a method borrowed from natural sciences, namely that of defined procedures and sets of rules. This is not a work, it shows my working materials. If I adhere to this practice over a longer period of time, will I produce new other images? I have called my method proxy drawing technique. I limit my drawing activity to simple, repetitious and rapid movements of both the right and the left hands. Since I use all the colored pencils from the box in their random order, there is no longer any choice of colors to be made. This work has a title, Proxy 6, 111 drawings, colored pencil on paper. Each size is 18 to 25 centimeters. Concept of the work. The fact that the International Scientific Research Human Genome Project mainly produced uncertainties attracted me to work with the topic of genetics. I drew my inspiration for the project Empty Space of the Unknown, Nothing is Right Now, from Die Abschaffung der Gene, The Abolition of Genes, a radio program which I had listened to in 2015. In this broadcast, the results of the 2003 Human Genome Project were described as a shock to the scientific community. Contrary to what they had assumed, scientists had discovered that humans have only about 20,000 genes, approximately the same number as a fruit fly, Drosophila. How this discovery can contribute to the explanation of the complexity of human beings is still a mystery until today. The state of knowledge, which was assumed to be factual, that genes alone are responsible for the transmission of hereditary traits had to be fundamentally called into question. Although genes can currently be fully sequenced, the delivered information cannot be dependably interpreted. The genetic material of life is said to be contained in the pairs of chemical bases, adenine, thymine, guanine, and cytosine. In my project, genetics take on the role of a field of reference pointing towards something in the future that cannot yet be named. For the first proxy drawings, I chose the letters A, T, G, and C as my initial motives. This work has the title Proxy 21. It's as well colored pencil on paper. Each size of one hanging drawing has 185 to 75 centimeters. After working for several years in the proxy drawing technique, I have experienced that the restrictions enforced to my practice open up an endless number of possibilities. In the countless repetition, my perception has become sensitive to incidental occurrences. These observations flow directly into my further work procedure. My initial set of rules thus undergoes constant variations, retaining its basic principle, reaching limits, beginning to dissolve, regaining meaning. Thank you for listening.
Thank you very much. Just two questions. We won't make it too long because it's already late. So what I get from your presentation of your recent work, particularly that I had not known before, you have decided to do something again and again and again in a very restricted way, in a very repetitious way, just over and over again in order to invite something surprising or something unexpected. Can you tell us how long you have worked on this method and on this series?
It's not so easy to answer because I didn't count the hours or the day, but it takes a long of time. For example, one hanging drawing, yeah, it needs, I can't do it one day, all one day. 3 days, one drawing.
Okay, but how many years have you been working with this method, and how much of your working time do you devote to this method?
Yeah, I'm working on this project in this technique for more than 5 years, and I think it's about approximately 80% of my work in the studio.
So that's pretty much, and it reminds me of what many scientists do the same kind of method for a very long time and hoping that some results will occur, which again reminds me of my favorite philosopher of science, Ludwig Fleck, who described exactly that. That's what we do. We wait for something unexpected, urgently, and sometimes it occurs. I can imagine that when you do that for such a long time, you won't do it the same time. You won't do it the same way all over, right? Your practice will change after a time. What exactly is changing while you're doing this?
Yeah, the repetition provokes a clearer perception, and then this is a process ongoing and. For example, on the right drawing, you see the white spaces, the round white spots. Thank you. Sorry. And this is a consequence of perceiving my work. When I, during looking at the drawing, suddenly I perceived round dots. And if I have this image in my mind, I continue to see in this net of lines round dots. I haven't seen it before. But when this image in my mind, okay, I always see these round spots. And then I decided during the process, okay, I will tape up these round forms and continue. And after finishing, I took away the tape. And so they are the white spots. You can't plan it. It happens, and you need an intensive perception.
Thank you very much. And to round up this, I would like to also tell you that Katrin's work will be covered in the Deutsche Hygiene Museum in Dresden in 2022 in an exhibition titled Code of Life, which is about genetics and genomics. And with us, thank you very much, Daniela, and the floor is yours again.
Thank you very much, Veronica. I think I should add, and I have forgotten about that, doing that earlier, that Veronica is professor of for liberal arts and sciences here at the University of Freiburg and has done a lot of research on the history of science. So she has a real knowledge. And she said, well, you should meet up with the artist of Katharine von Lehmann, but you should definitely meet up with Veronica as well. So that is a good starting point then. Thank you very much for the presentation of your impressive work. And we feel very honored that you are here today and telling us about your arts. And actually, one of the pictures has inspired me a little bit because you showed a network of woven pictures. And I think this is a very nice metaphor for the Young Academy. It couldn't be better than that. It's built out of different small pieces, which all have a meaning on itself. But then it's interwoven with each other, and it gets a different meaning. It gets more lively. It gets a different, well, inspiration as well. And I think this is what we expect from the Young Academy as well. So thank you very much for this. We come to conclude this evening, and I would like to thank everybody to stay here with us, who meet, and of course, in particular, to those who have made this event possible, to the musician, to the organizers, to everybody here, coming here, and all of those who were presented on the stage and who ensured that everything ran smoothly in the background, you and the audience here on site or in stream. Thank you for your interest. It is now up to us to wish all fellows here in the room and the others as well an inspiring time in the Young Academy for Sustainability. And we will for sure hear about you, and we are excited to get in touch with you. And I think even the mayor of the of Freiburg is excited because we have already heard some ideas about transforming the city. So if you want to know more about the Young Academy, you can find further information on the homepage of FRIES, of course. But for those who are here in the room, should better take the chance and talk to the people and to the fellows right after I have stopped talking here. And this is a good opportunity to cordially invite you all to the reception in the Prometheus Hall, just right out of this hall route. And let's get into exchange with each other now and enjoy the evening. Thank you very much for everything.